Okay, good afternoon. I would like to start. Okay, so we're considering now the situation of encoding of multiple inputs, right? And we laid out at the end of the last lecture a problem that we want to discuss. And I will start by discussing a special case, a somewhat simplified case, in which there's only one output unit. Okay, so that we have many input units and we have one output unit, and I remind you about the setup, but I will do it now specifically in this case. Okay, so we have our N input units, X1, up to xn, and they all project to an output unit, y. And we're doing things in the most simple way that we can. The output unit is linear. Okay, it's a linear output unit, and it's equal to the sum over wj xj plus some output noise. We realized in our discussion before that output noise is important. Because otherwise, if there's no output noise, the constraint that we're going to put on the output is not going to be meaningful. We'll see that in a moment. Okay, so this is the structure of the output. And we have a constraint that the variance of y should be something, right? So again, if we did not have output noise, we could make the variance of y as large as we want, and we could encode as much information in y as we wish. And the question now is really, what is the choice of the projection, right? What is the choice of the weight? Now, I remind you, in the case that we will discuss later, we will have multiple outputs, there will be two questions. One is, what is the substrate of the input space that we keep, or what is the substrate that we throw away, and then how do we choose the weight within the substrate? Here, it's really just the choice of the substrate, right? The magnitude of y, once we choose the direction of w, the magnitude of y will be just set by the constraint, or the magnitude of the weight. Okay, so what do we need to do? We need to write down, things like the variance of y. We'll need this both because of the constraint and because of the expression for the mutual information, which is what we want to optimize. We want to multiply the mutual information between y and x. Okay, so let's write do some technical calculation. We need the variance of y. So this is the variance of w transpose x squared plus the variance of v out, or the mean square of v out. Now, why didn't I put a mixed term? Because they're independent, but it's, in general, when we square something, we also have a mixed term, so just note that there was some assumption about the noise that went into this part. And so let me write this as w transpose x. This is a number, and I write this number again in the following way. I will write it also as x transpose w. Right? And the variance of the output we assume is delta. And now I note that in this average, the weights are not are fixed, right? We will consider the variance for fixed weight, so I can take them out of the average. And so this is W transpose, average of XX transpose W plus delta. Now if we would write this in indexes, what we would have here is sum over I, J, K, W, W, I, X, J, X, K, W, K, K, but then we sum over all the W, so it will end up being sum over W, I, X, J, X, I, W, sorry, W, I, W, W, J, W, X, J, X, K, and then K equals to I, okay? You do it yourself. So my point is that this is really the matrix that we called C, which is the covariance matrix, okay? And, right, so Cij is equal to Xi, Xj, and but if we would turn this into a sum over indices, we can, you know, this W transpose Cw W is equal to a sum over I and J Xi Cj Cj Cij W Xj. Okay, we'll go there. W, I, X, C, I, J, W, J, thank you. Right, because we have here W, I, J, X, J, X, K, W, K, sorry, W, I, W is just a vector, W, I, X, I, X, J, W, J. And that's what we have here. All right, so in the end, what we get here is the expression that looks like this, WC, W transpose CW plus delta. Now, we need this for two reasons. We need this because of the constraints, and we also need this because of the mutual information. I remind you that Y is a linear sum over Gaussian variables, which are mutually Gaussian. The X, Xj's are a multidimensional Gaussian variable, and any linear sum over the components of a multidimensional Gaussian variable is a Gaussian. So why is a Gaussian? And we add the noise, which is also Gaussian. So why is a Gaussian? And therefore we know how to write the entropy of Y, and it involves the variance of Y. So the mutual information between Y and X is the entropy of Y minus the entropy of Y conditioned on X, and this is half ln 2 pi E the variance of Y. This is this part, because Y is Gaussian, and this part is even easier. Y condition on X is some number plus the noise. The variance of the noise is delta. So here we'll have half ln 2 pi E delta. Okay. And therefore, this is equal to half ln Y squared. I would plug in the expression that we have here, W transpose C W plus delta, divided by delta. This comes from here. Now, our constraint is that the variance of Y, W transpose C W plus delta, is equal to Q. Now, as I already mentioned before, the constraint really chooses the magnitude of, we can think about the constraint of choosing the magnitude of W. In other words, we can think about choosing W in the following way. We need to choose the direction of W in the n-dimensional space, and the amplitude, the magnitude of the vector W, but the magnitude of the vector W will be chosen by this constraint. So let's write this more formally. Let's write W as some vector, unit vector in the n-dimensional space. Right? So this is a vector whose norm is equal to 1, times some amplitude. And the amplitude, for convenience, I will call square root of alpha, just a number. And now you see that the constraint here means that alpha, we have here alpha because we have square root of alpha twice, alpha times w hat and c w hat plus delta is equal to q, and therefore alpha is determined by the constraint. Alpha is equal to q divided by w transpose, so the transpose missing here, c w plus delta. Okay. But now I can plug this in this expression. So the way I'm thinking about it, for any choice of the direction of W, the amplitude of W is set by the constraint, and then we plug this into the expression for the mutual information, and now we have the mutual information just as a function of the direction of W. So, but then something a bit weird happened. Yes? Yes, yes, definitely, absolutely. Okay, so now something funny happens. We have this expression for W, and it obeys, you know, alpha obeys this constraint. So, in fact, you can see directly that from here that I could have written the numerator here just as Q. So once we've satisfied the constraint, we find that I of Y and X is just equal to half ln Q over delta. Why is that a bizarre result? Or at least an unsatisfying result. Yeah, it's completely independent of the direction of W. So it seems like the whole, you know, we worked hard, we did this calculation, and we found that it doesn't matter how we choose the direction of W. We have, regardless of the direction of W, we'll have the same mutual information between Y and X. So when we get a result of this type, there are two options. One is that we made a mistake along the way, but we didn't. The other possibility is that something is wrong in how we formulated the problem. It signals to us that there's something missing. We thought, you know, that it would matter how we choose the projection, but in the way we formulated the problem, it actually doesn't matter. And so we want to understand what is going on. So let me try to discuss this in a geometrical manner. So imagine that X is a two-dimensional variable, or I mean, at least I will draw projection in two dimensions, and X is distributed as some vector X is distributed as some Gaussian variable, and you already know that if we look at the contours of equal probability of a Gaussian variable, they look like ellipses. So, in general, okay, I'm not very good at drawing a nice ellipse, but I will try to improve it. So this ellipse has two, what we call principal axes. In other words, if we rotate if we look at the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix of X, it will tell us what is the rotation in space, such that after we do that rotation, we have two directions in which we have just a multiplication of two Gaussians. So if we would rotate the coordinate axis and look at the position along this direction, these two variables will be independent. This is just a reminder. You discussed this with Netta. Okay, so anyway, we have this variable which is distributed as a Gaussian, and again, what I'm drawing here is contour of equal probability. So it's more likely to be here, and probability goes down, and we can fall anywhere along these points. Now, what do we do when we choose the direction of W? When we choose the direction of W, we actually project X along some particular direction, right? Suppose that this is the direction of W, so we project X along this direction. And the next thing that we do is that, so depending on which direction we choose, we might have different variants for this projection, right? If we choose this direction, the variance will be smallest. If we choose this direction, the variance will be largest. But we'll end up, in any case, with some Gaussian variable. And then what we do is we, essentially by choosing this alpha, we blow it up such that it will have a particular variance that we want. So let's imagine that the variance that we want, which is really Q minus delta, because the variance of the projection should be the total variance minus the projection of the output noise. So we have some, let's draw some circle with radius Q minus delta. So, if we chose, for example, this direction, we need to blow up the variance of the projection such that it will multiply by the factor such that the variance would be what we need. So this is what we're doing, right? And now the question is, why is the mutual information independent of the choice of direction? So, what is limiting in our formulation the information that we convey about X? Why do we not convey infinite information about X?
Maybe we just change Q as having some part that's independent.
Okay, maybe. But let's just first answer my question, which is, what is limiting the fact, what is in the way you formulated the problem, why is there a limit about for that mutual information between Y and X?
Because there's noise,
right? There's output noise. So remember, what are we doing? We're taking this variable after we blew it up, and then we're corrupting it by noise, by output noise, and corrupting it by output noise with variance delta means that essentially it's like discretizing the output variable with a resolution of about square root of delta. So it's this, we encode it. Imagine that we encode this variable with some limited resolution, right? And the resolution is like square root of delta. Now the point is that actually, regardless of how we choose the direction of W, after we blow up, we have a Gaussian variable at the input. After we blow it up to this direction, it's always a Gaussian with the same variance. And then we convey a certain amount of information about it because of the discretization at the output. Now, intuitively, what would seem to you to be the best direction to choose in order to convey as much information about X in this problem?
Well,
the The one with the largest variance. Why?
Because then you take the division is more fit on the
okay, but you see that formally, mathematically, that it doesn't, this, our formulation doesn't say that, and it's not just a technical point. It's real. We had a Gaussian variable if we choose this. We have a Gaussian variable if we choose this. We blow them up to have the same amplitude, and then we discretize. We get the same amount of information. So what is missing? Something is missing in our formulation, which is fundamental. And this is what will make our near the intuition that this direction is better meaningful. What could be missing? Why could it be that it's better to to blow up? Suppose, for example, that this ellipse would be very very narrow. There would be like very brittle little bands along this direction. What's possibly bad about blowing up?
That afterwards you are discretizing by the so that you have many things that convey the same.
Okay, but why would that be a problem in terms of the amount of information? What can we add to the formulation that will make this a problem? Why is it meaningful for me to know, to discretize? Why would it be more meaningful for me to discretize, this along this direction than, to blow up something very small and then discretize?
Because you're discretizing at the same size, so.
Okay. I want to, in the same spirit of things that we've done so far.
It's wasting your capacity if you're passing information.
So far I'm passing information about X. It doesn't matter if it's in this direction or I blew up this to a large. It's really information about X.
Yeah, but there is more information.
But the intuition, I think that the intuition is that it's actually it's not information about X if we blow up this. Blow up this direction, but why could it that be the case?
You're still conveying information about X.
No, not the same amount of information. That it has to do with the fact that a continuous variable, whatever.
Maybe if you want to discretize it, then if it's really very narrow, then different X's are all corresponding to the same actual.
Okay, but in terms of information so far, it's the theory information doesn't care about, if it's close or not close, it's how much.
But
that's
always when you discretize it, then you do care. And you're forcing because of the discretization.
Think about noise. You remember that we rescued our theory for encoding, nonlinear encoding of a single variable by including output noise. What could we add to our theory now to have your okay, so I led you to the answer, but that's a good answer. If we imagine that X is corrupted by noise also at the level of the input, then things start to matter, because if we take, in this direction, we blow a little bit, fine, but if in this direction, and let's imagine that this ellipse is very narrow, we blow X up, but we're mostly blowing up the noise and not the actual X. Okay? So,
is it only also if the noise is dependent on X or is it dependent?
Well, it will be to some extent true, but then it will depend on how it depends. We're not going to discuss that possibility, of course. One possibility could be that the variance of the noise is exactly proportional to this ellipse, and then it won't matter. If we imagine that we have some additive noise which doesn't have this structure, which is the same in all directions, then it's better to choose a direction in which we have a lot of, once we blow up this variable which is now corrupted by noise, we're mostly, most of the variance comes from X and not from the noise. Okay? So that's the intuition. And now we want to formalize it and see that things work out as expected. So we have a modified model. And I will write write it down as already for the case of multi-dimensional outputs, that's because we will use it in both cases. But then we will go back first to the one-dimensional case. So our inputs are xi plus zi in, I dot of 1 to n. Our outputs are y, j, which are the projection, which are w transpose x, w is now a matrix, plus z in vector. All this is element j, plus zj out. Okay, so we have both input noise. Okay, and sorry, this is like this. So W acts on the inputs corrupted by the noise, and there's output noise. And so you'll see that the input noise and the output noise play have a different role mathematically, in the sense that this is additive after multiplication by W, but this the input noise is multiplied by W, and this is why it would matter. And of course, the average of Z in I is equal to the average of Z out J is equal to zero, and the Gaussian, and Zi in Zj in is equal to epsilon delta I J. So this will be the variance of the input noise, and Zi out Zj out delta ij, this is the variance of the output noise. And so this is a modified model. And our goal is the same as before. We want to maximize the mutual information between between y and x. And I will leave it as an exercise for you to write down the covariance matrix of y. So I'm still in the multidimensional, I'm still writing it in the multidimensional case. So there will be a part which has to do with the covariance of the inputs of the xn, as before. There will be a part which has to do with the covariance of the with the input noise. And it's by the way, I mean, the fact, once you know that this is what you have without input noise, it's quite clear that you will have a term like this, because the covariance, you know, before we corrupt by the noise, the covariance of x plus v in is just the covariance of x plus the covariance of V in, which is a unity matrix. So this is like writing W transpose C plus epsilon I W, right? Okay, so this is the part coming from the input noise, and then there's the part coming from the output noise. This is a M by M matrix, right? Alright, and you see also in this expression that the output noise has a different impact on y than the input noise, because this part is independent of w, whereas this part is dependent of w. Okay, so now let's go back to a single output unit. So we just have one output unit, so the variance of this output unit is W transpose C W. W is now simply a vector. plus epsilon W transpose W plus delta. So this is what has been added to the expression that we had before. And the mutual information between y and x is given by half ln 2 pi e y squared minus half the mutual the entropy of y condition on x. Now the entropy of y condition on x would be, I mean, the variance of y condition on x would be this expression without this part. Maybe I will write it down. The variance of y squared conditioned on x, it's a bit of sloppy notation, but you understand what I mean, given x, y still has contributions to its variance for both from the input noise and from the output noise, and the expression is simply epsilon w transpose w plus delta. So we have here minus half ln 2 pi e. Let me write it like this. And now I will use these two expressions. So this is half ln 2 pi e. And W transpose, the 2 pi e is cancelled because we have this divided by this. So we have W transpose CW plus epsilon W transpose W plus delta divided by W transpose, by epsilon W transpose W plus delta. What we had before, and now we have added this term coming from the input. And our constraint is coming from this. The constraint is that W transpose CW plus epsilon W transpose W is equal to Q minus delta. So what has changed is that now the constraint and the optimization goal are not uniquely related to each other, which is what was the problem before. Before, what we had here in the numerator was directly related to the constraint. So once you satisfy the constraint, the mutual information is set. And it doesn't matter which direction of W you choose. Now it's not the case. Now, once we set the constraint, because of this part, the denominator, we still haven't uniquely determined I, and I will depend on the choice of the direction of W, and let's see how in more detail. And now I will play the same game, or the same, think about it in the same way as before. I would say, we'll choosing the direction of W, and the magnitude of W will be set by the constraint. So we will write W as square root of alpha W hat, where this has magnitude Y, and we'll think about the direction of W as what we're varying. And if we do that, what we get for alpha, I will do it a bit, I will just skip the algebra, which is simple. What we get for alpha is the following. And this is the choice of alpha that will satisfy the constraint. And now we can take this expression and plug it in here. I mean, we will write W transpose CW is alpha times W hat transpose CW. And again, there's some algebra that I will skip. And you can check at home. And what we get is my expression. Now, the important thing is that I just want to think, what have we done here? What is important is that we now parameterize, we wrote the Newton information only as a function of the direction of W. If we eliminated from the expression whatever we can using the constraints. So we now have, instead of a W which was constrained to have particular magnitude such that the variance of Y will be set according to the constraint, now we have complete freedom to choose the direction of W hat, and the magnitude has been set appropriately. Now we can look at this expression, and it might seem a bit complicated, but in fact it's telling us something very, very simple. And the reason it's telling us something very, very simple is that what you have here, Q and delta are constants, so it's epsilon and delta. And what you have here is a monotonic function of this thing. So this thing is a monotonically increasing function of what? Of W hat transpose CW hat. And therefore, what we want to choose is that direction in which this quantity is maximum. What is this? What is W transpose CW? In this plot, what does it represent? Magnitude of this ellipsoid. It's a variance. If we project on a unit vector in direction W hat, it tells us what will be the variance of X projected on that direction. Okay. So how will it look like in the choice of the direction of W in this case? Just like this ellipse. It will be maximal if the direction is this direction. It will go down. Here it will be minimal. Right? So what you see is that the theory is now telling us that to maximize the mutual information between Y and X, we need to choose a projection on the direction in which the variance of X is maximum. And this is what is called the first principal component of X. So let's see. Yeah, the matrix C, and which describes the. So let me write this down. maximizing W transpose C W under the constraint that under the constraint that W is the unit vector, W transpose W is equal to 1. And therefore, W hat is the first principal component. I will write PC because I might use this notation again. Principal component. Principal component, principal axis. Now you see that this is what the math is telling us, but I want to repeat the intuition that we could have understood without doing the math. The intuition is that once we have input noise, you know, it's better to blow up a projection which has a lot of variance coming from X, because then most of the variance of the variable that we're encoding is coming from what we care about, which is X. Whereas if we choose a direction like this, then most of the variance of the variable that we end up encoding comes from the noise. Okay, so it's so we're blowing up the noise instead of the signal that we care about. All right. So let's take a break. Thank you.
כן, כאילו, אבל זה לא כאילו בדרך. כאילו, זה בדיוק חזובה, כזו של הצעירים. כאילו, של הנורמון. ברוך, כך, רוחב של...
אחת בין נעדה שמה, השנייה...
לבד.
What I meant was someone who said the intuition, I just messed it up somewhere in the way. It's sort of that you're projecting this to the other people, exactly. And then it gets to be the norm of the projection, and the norm of the projection is exactly what you said. The norm of the projection is exactly the length that the cycle there. So one thing is why multiplying it by W. It's actually projecting it and then taking it off. Now, what is okay, so we don't have a problem with it, like the equation for projection. But I think projection is a dog problem. Yeah, that's what we're exactly trying to like say what it is exactly. Mom's
תגידו, סי יפה זה כמו סי, לא יפה?
זה עולם אחר.
גם אתה כתב משהו עליי, סי
לא יפה?
אז זה סי שעוד לא הכרנו? זוכרת מה שהיה שום מנסה אתמול? זה כזה מתוגן וכל מיני צבעים?
לא יודע,
כאילו לא בדיוק את זה, פשוט
זה יוצא?
זה יוצא יום ראשון. אבל גם יום חמישי שלפני זה אפשר לשבת.
אוקיי, אני חושב, אני טס לחול ביום שני, אז אני חושב שיום ראשון הוא עוד בסדר. אבל אני רק אבדה את זה. Alright, so we finally we reached the satisfying situation in which we formulated the theory in a way which gives us meaningful results, and in fact that this geometric reasoning could have led us to understand that projection on the largest principal components should be the best choice for maximizing the mutual information once we include the noise in the appropriate manner. And I would like to remind you again what is the role of the output noise and what is the role of the input noise. So the role of the output noise was to make the constraint meaningful. This is something that has to do with the outputs. The role of the input noise had to do with the choice of projection direction in the input space. And so this is something that has to do. Now, we will soon, next, probably already only on Thursday, discuss the multidimensional case. Today I want to discuss the remaining time today a few other issues. And the first one of them is that we found this result that the best projection for a single neuron is the projection picks up the direction in which the inputs have the largest variance. We find this result under certain assumptions that what we want to maximize is mutual information, but we also assume that all the variables are Gaussian. And what I want to mention a bit briefly is that a similar conclusion about the best choice of receptive field or projection can be obtained by another formulation of the theory with a different optimization goal and somewhat different assumptions. So let me do this here. So we can imagine the following problem. Imagine that we have our inputs, and I will now draw them vertically. This is x1, this is xn. And we project them into some output neuron, output unit, linearly. Now imagine that what we want to be able to do is to reconstruct the inputs based on this single variable as best as we can. But when I say as best as we can, more specifically, I mean in terms of the mean square error. So I will explain, I will write this down formally. So the idea is that now, you know, we kind of encoded the input, this vector, the input vector, into single output unit. And now we want to generate our best possible reconstruction of this vector based on the output unit. So we project the y into output values that I will call x1 tilde up to xn tilde. And we have linear projections in both parts of this scheme, so y sum over I w I x I and x j tilde is some w j tilde times y, or in vector notation I would write that y is w transpose x and x tilde vector is y times w tilde vector. But y is given by this, so I could also write that x tilde vector is actually equal to x transpose to w transpose x. So you see that this x is some matrix, the x tilde is some matrix that multiplies, so the linear relationship between the x tilde and the x. And now, as I mentioned, our goal would be to minimize the construction error. So I will also write it here, because this is the alternative principle, minimal reconstruction error. But let's write it formally. So our goal would be to minimize the mean square error in the following sense. Sum over I x I minus x I tilde squared. So I'm summing the square error of the reconstruction, and my goal is to minimize that. And so now, in this problem, formulation of the problem, we have no noise, no input noise, no output noise. We just have the inputs. We're projecting them into this unit. We're trying to reconstruct. Everything is linear. And the question is, what are our variables here? Our variables here are both the these W's and these W's, right? The W's and the W tildes. So we can search for the choice of the W and W tilde that will actually minimize this quantity. And they would not do it, but we will do it as an exercise. And so the solution ends up being the solution is that W and W tilde are both proportional to the first principal component of the thing. So if we want to be able to, you know, we project W into a single variable, if we want to be able to reconstruct W to the best mean square error, we want to project W in the direction in which W varies the most. It kind of makes sense. In the extreme case where W varies only in one direction, of course this is what we would want to do. We would not care about that one. Yes.
Sorry, I was a little bit, maybe that could guide. We have the one, two, we don't know, our goal is to have the x axis to be x equals to x tilde.
The x tilde is equal as much as possible to the end.
Why we don't set like y equals 1 and the weight equal?
Because the x varies. Each time you have a different presentation of a different x, this will not work.
Because the x...
y is a function of the x, conveys some information about the, you know, information about the x. For one thing, in some sense, in this case, this result is more general because we did not need to assume that the inputs are Gaussian. Right? We did not assume. Okay, you need to go through the exercise to see that.
The principle is not maximizing information, does not assume that it's...
Well, when we discussed mutual information, we assumed that the inputs are Gaussian, and that assumption was important.
Just to derive the final solution.
So, yeah, but in there are situations in which projecting into the principal components is not the best thing.
For
maximizing information.
To maximize information is not the best thing, but here is
But here is always the best thing. Then regardless of the distribution of the... So if you want mean squared error, principal component, self-principal component, the best projection. If you want maximal information, it's not necessarily the case. In what we discussed, it was, but it relied on the fact that we assume that the inputs are Gaussian. So, again, so indeed.
Doesn't it mean that somehow this, you can use all the information to make a prediction on it?
Well, okay, I'm not sure I understand the. Thinking about it, I mean, some things that do matter here are this particular choice of the error measure.
The error measure was the maximum information to maximize here. Like I'm trying to think why it is not equivalent. How can you formalize?
Well, for example, let's think about another situation in which it would not be equivalent. Inputs are Gaussian, but the noise is not independent, you know, the different variables. Okay? So, but it's weak. If the noise is very weak, I didn't include any noise in the discussion. But if the noise is sufficiently weak, in this case, this problem is well defined, regardless of, you know, this problem can be formulated without any noise. So if the noise is weak, then the structure of the noise will not matter in this problem. In the discussion of mutual information, it will matter. Okay. So that's another way to see that that assumptions really matter. So it's I think there's a more general lesson from one of the reasons I'm mentioning this different formulation is that there's a general lesson coming from this. Suppose that we observe that you know neurons in the brain are picking up the direction of maximal variance, the first principle component. There are different interpretations to this. We have two different theories which are not exactly the same, that both predict this result. And assume different things about what are the constraints and what are the goals of the what are the optimization goals. Then in fact it would not matter which direction you could choose, you know, one of them, you could choose the second, or you can choose any linear combination of them, won't matter. And this is also that there is no one first principle component. This is the case where this ellipse is circular and all the directions have this maximal variance. But if you have two variables which are independent and one of them has a larger variance, then you will want to just choose that variable, because that will be the principal component.
And same W tilde?
Yes. W tilde will be the same. So you just throw away the other one.
So why basically W and W tilde is always similar to in front maximize?
So actually, if you think about it a bit more, I don't want to spend more time on this now, but you can think about this problem and gain a lot of intuition from it. If you think about just two variables, why is it that we want to choose one? You know, one of them has a higher variance than the second. Why did we want to choose that one and not the second one? And in fact, if you think about n independent variables, you can almost understand everything from that case. At least, you know, if they're Gaussian, then you can understand everything from that case, because if they're not independent, you can always rotate the coordinate axis so that they will be independent. So this is a useful way to think about it, but I will leave it for you to think about it. Alright, so this is just something that I wanted to mention briefly. Another topic or another question that I would like to address rather relatively briefly is a question of learning. Suppose that you have a neuron which receives n inputs and it has these synaptic waves that connect it to the inputs. Is there some simple learning rule that will allow this neuron to update its synapses such that it picks up the direction with maximal variance, the first principal component? And when I say simple learning rule, what we want from a learning rule is that it will be, we could imagine that it would be mapped to a biological learning rule. And in a biological learning rule, it makes sense that the change in a synapse could depend on the activity of the presynaptic neuron, the postsynaptic neuron, but maybe that's it. We don't want it to depend on other variables which the synapse doesn't see. Okay? So this is the question. And it turns out that there is a very simple learning rule that achieves this goal. And it's called Hoyer's learning rule. So we have our inputs, x1 to xn. We have our output unit, y. And again, we will ignore noise. So the output unit is summing up the inputs linearly. change of the sign. So we imagine that after each presentation of a stimulus, we change each one of the weights. So I will start by writing a particular rule, but then I will modify it a little bit. So we'll start by writing the following rule. The change in synapse I after the presentation, of the n plus 1 stimulus will be equal to eta, which is just some number, times the value of y. So this is after the presentation of the n stimulus. So this will be the value of the output after the presentation of the n stimulus and the input to that particular.
The stimulus is changing all the x's altogether?
So, if we imagine that we each time we present the stimulus to all the x's.
So, it's a vector every time?
It's a vector. X is a vector each time. Y computes with this linear sum. And then the synapse, Wi, is updated. So this is Wi. Wi is updated based on the output and on the input unit that that synapse Wi is connected to. So this is a local learning rule in the sense, again, that the synapse from this neuron to this neuron updates in a way that depends on the activity of this neuron and the two neurons that the synapse connects. Okay. We will call this the learning rate for obvious reasons. And this rule is often called the Hebbian learning rule because it corresponds to the notion that synapses between neurons that are active together, if both y is large and x is large, neurons that are active together are enhanced. Okay. All right, so this is certainly a reasonably biological rule. But if we would just use this rule as it is, we would have a problem.
Does the rule update all the weights?
Yes. In the terms of our discussion on time, this is a cartoon of real life because we're discretizing each time we have a vector x, an output, we immediately update all the weights and then we take the next presentation. Alright, so there's one problem if we apply this rule continuously, and this is that if this is what we do, some of the weights will tend to blow up and some of the weights will tend to go to zero or to become negative, tend to go to zero. So we will include another step in our update, which is a normalization of all the weights. So we will add to that weight normalization, and therefore our Wi n plus 1 will not be given by what I wrote here. It will be given by Wi n plus plus this. So this is what we would do if we would only do this step, but then we divide this by some normalization factor, which is the following. So note that this is just the sum of the squares of what is written in the numerator, but that now the sum is over all the units. So what this does is that it ensures that W transpose W is equal to 1 always. Now, is this biological? To some extent you can say yes, it's a rule which is local to this neuron. Means that there's some, it's not local in the sense that the updates to this synapse depends on the state of all the to be some process within this neuron that constantly normalize the sum of the weights going into that, the standards of going into that. It's not ridiculous to assume that something like this could exist. Anyway, mathematically, this is what we do, and now we want to analyze what will happen due to this rule. And and what I want to focus on is what happens when eta is small. So the learning rate is small. And when I say small, I mean two things. You will see as we do the analysis. So we use the fact that eta is small in two different ways. One of the ways in which I will assume that eta is small is that I will assume that I can take this expression and linearize it with respect to eta. So if eta was zero, we would just have here that w doesn't change at all. And we write the first order correction to this, the linear part in eta. So let's start by the denominator. So the denominator is sum over W J plus eta X eta Y XJ. I'm now omitting the N index just for simplicity, just because it's annoying to write it all the time. So if I want to expand this, how do I do it? So this is the sum over J. So this is 1 over the square root.
You're just dealing with the denominator?
Yeah, I just want to write now to expand the denominator of first order, and then I will multiply it by the expansion of first order of the number. But it's just for convenience, let's just deal with that, with this part first. So the zero, so if eta is zero, I will get here sum over j wj squared, right? And the term which is linear in eta is a sum over j eta, so let's write the eta before the sum, there's eta times sum over times y times sum over j xj wj. And there's a 2, no, so, yeah, there is a 2. And there's a third term, which is something which is eta squared. I will not write it explicitly, because I don't care about eta squared, I want to linearize. Now, this is, I'm using here the somewhat sloppy notation in which I didn't write the indices. These are the weights from the previous step, and they're already normalized, right? So this is just equal to 1. So the first order in eta, what we have here is 1 over square root of 1 plus 2 before I write down. Here you see you have sum over j w x j w j. What is that? That's y. So we have here 2 eta y squared. Sum over, the sum over j, we already do it. And if you remember the, now I need to expand the 1 over square root. So 1 over square root of 1 plus x to first order is 1 minus half x. So I will get here 1 minus eta y squared. This is what I get in the denominator. Good. Now, we still need to multiply this by the numerator. And of course, you know, there are terms here which are order eta squared, but I don't care. I won't care about it. So, wi n plus 1 to first order in eta is, now I look at this expression here, this is really just something plus eta. There's only a linear term in eta here. So it's wi n plus eta y n x I n times 1 minus eta y n squared plus higher order terms. And so to first order I get w I n plus eta y n x I n minus w minus eta. Okay, so this is this came from this times this, and I also have this times this. So I have w I n w y n squared plus I have. Okay, so I use the fact that eta is small in order to do this linearization, to neglect higher order terms in eta. Now I will use the fact that eta is small in another way. Let me write the change, the average change in wi at the nth step. The average change in I. I can average over these things. So I took this minus this. I have eta. Now I need to average. What am I averaging on? So on average, I can say that delta wi is equal to eta times the average of y x minus xi minus wi, the average of y squared. Now, this is correct. I mean, up to the linearization, this is correct. But it still doesn't tell me what will happen to w in each step, because this is a stochastic variable. It depends on which, you know, this is just telling me what is the average change in w. However, if w is changing sufficiently slowly, if the eta is sufficiently small, then we're going to average over many, many presentations during which the w itself won't change much, so this expression will be the current statistics. We can, when we evaluate this thing over these many presentations, we can still think about the w as if it's fixed. And then we will have something which really samples the statistics of this these covariance between y and x, and the variance of y. And so this is a bit similar to what I discussed when I discussed the stochastic gradient descent, that if the learning edge is sufficiently small, I will not write this very formally right now, if the learning edge is sufficiently small, these dynamics which are stochastic essentially become deterministic, in the sense that the change in W becomes equal to this statistic. Again, we have many, many samples. In all of them, we sample these statistics well, so there's a certain mean, and the variance across all these samples, examples becomes small compared to the mean. So I will not do this more formally, but I will just write that when the learning is sufficiently small, so the learning is sufficiently slow, I can say that I will write it in the following way, that the dW I to dt is proportional to eta times the covariance of y and xi minus wi y squared. And when I say wi to dt, I kind of introduced time into this. Everything was in discrete steps, so this is why I'm writing here proportional, because you can imagine that there's a certain delta t associated with each step, and this has to do with this proportionality constant. But the more important thing is that now you see that I have here deterministic equations. The change in the W just depends on the W itself in two ways. It depends directly here, and it depends also because the Ws determine what are these quantities. All right. Before we continue to understand what these dynamics tell us, I will mention that this rule can be derived in the context of minimization of square reconstruction error. So if you write down we went very briefly through the fact that reconstruction error leads to principal component extraction, you can write this error function and ask what is the gradient of the mean square of the reconstruction error with respect to the weights, and end up with a rule that looks like this. So this suggests that this rule should indeed implement gradient descent on the reconstruction error, and therefore it should lead to the choice of the principal component. But we can actually see that directly from these dynamics, because we can ask what is the steady state of these dynamics. So the steady state, in steady state, this needs to be zero for each I, meaning that yxi is equal to wi y squared for all I. And let's write this down a bit more in more detail. So the y I will write as sum over j wj xj. And I will know that the W's I can take out of the averaging, because the averaging is over the X's. So this can be written as sum over J, WJ, XI, XJ. This is this part. And this is what we call the covariance matrix of the X's. And here we have a WI. If I will write that y as sum over I x j, and then we have another, sorry, sum over I w I x I, and then we have another y, let's write it down, this is sum over I w I x I multiplied by sum over j w j x j. So I can take when I average, I can take the w's outside, and so I will get sum over J, okay, I will use a different index because I have here all the I, so let's put here WJ, XJ, and here K. These are just summation indices, so here I have a WI, and here I will have a sum over J and K, WI, average of XJ, XK, WK. This is CJK. So in matrix notation, you see that what we get here is that the matrix C multiplying the vector W is equal to, all this is something which is proportional to the vector W, because like what we have here is the ith element of C multiplying W. Here we have WI, so this is just the vector W. And all this is multiplied by a number, and this number is W transpose CW. So this is the same as this matrix notation.
The W sums DJ, no?
Where? In which sum? Here?
Yeah.
Here you have, this is, yes, thank you. Thank you. This is WJ. So the index I appears only here, and this, therefore this is something proportional to the vector WI, and all this is a number. And this is just a number. Okay, what does this equation tell us? Yes, good. So without, you know, trying to solve it, we just you know, C applied to W is a number times W. So if this is true, W has to be an eigenvector of C. Good. So what we conclude from this is that a steady state, if this dynamics leads to some steady state, the vector W that at steady state will be an eigenvector of C. For one thing, it tells us that you could choose any, you know, you could choose any eigenvector. If you choose W to be any eigenvector of C, it will stop changing by the Euler rule. So this is not yet what we want. We want a particular eigenvector, right? We want the principal, first principal component. So it turns out that this is not the whole story. It's not just interesting to ask what are the steady states of the dynamics. Even more important to ask what are the stable steady states of the dynamics. So it's true that every one of the eigenvectors of C is a steady state of the dynamics, but for most of them, if you will vary a little bit W from that vector, the perturbation will grow. It will be an unstable steady state. And I'm not showing it to you here, but you can prove that the only one for which it's stable is the first.